Good afternoon. My name is John Deutch. I am the very junior co-chair of this task force that we're here to discuss today. And I will try and moderate the session. I want to say thank you to Pete Peterson and to Richard Haas for organizing this very well-attended meeting. And then I'm asked to also make two other remarks. The first is turn off your cell phones. And the second is that this is a meeting on the record and has been should have been described to everybody in that way. What I suggest that we do is that we ask James Rodney Schlesinger to describe the task force and its reasoning. And after that, I may add just a couple of minutes to polish some of the remarks. And then we will throw it open for a discussion from all of you on any subject that you wish to raise. This has been a very interesting task force report, one interesting activity. And I think what is really noteworthy about it is we had a wide range of very talented and experienced people, and there is a common view about what the nature of this problem is. Jim.
I hope it's polishing. We have just, in the last 2 years, been through the first demand-driven price spike. It may be a harbinger of the future. It is likely to be a harbinger of the future. The effect has been to drive prices up to $60, $70 a barrel, and it has altered the balance of power, balance of diplomatic power in the world. This has been the central interest of the Council and its effect on our foreign policy position. What it has done is to weaken our foreign policy influence, and that, of course, is a national security problem. The countries that are exporting now have greater latitude for action or inaction in response to what we are doing. The countries that are importing have much less leverage. This is not confined to the United States, but since we pride ourselves on being the leading world power, it is much more, has a much higher impact on the on this country. If you look at the exporters, what we have seen is a increased defiance, if I may put use that term, in connection with Chavez in Venezuela, our ability to influence Iran with regard to nuclear questions has diminished as a result of the surge of export earnings, and most clearly in the case of Russia. Our comments on the growth of autocracy or the rescission to autocracy has been substantially affected. It is not only a question of the United States, it is a question for our European allies as well. As you will recall, just last year, when they reduced the amount of gas flowing into Ukraine, the effect was to cut the gas flowing westward from the Ukraine, since the Ukrainians took what they needed. And the Europeans at that point decided we've got to worry about energy security. And of course, having surveyed the question of energy security, they decided that the solution to their problems was to pray. That pray for the best. And that the dependence on Russia as a source of supply will increase. There will be some switching towards LNG, but not sufficient to avoid a steadily increasing dependence on natural gas supplies from Russia. What effect has this had? If you take a question such as the question of the future of Georgia and its problems with Russia, you've seen a diminution in the support that Georgia is receiving from the West. Georgian officials from the president on down keep talking about, we are moving towards democracy, we want to be part of the EU, we want to be part of NATO. We are counting on our Western friends to help us in our conflict with Russia. Answer, they are getting precious little help from their Western friends. A reflection of the expanded concerns in Western Europe about energy supply and recognition, acknowledgement of their dependence on Russia as a source of supply. In this respect, we have the Americans, have a similar concern with China. The Chinese, as they have moved forward in terms of industrial production, now have more than half of their oil supply coming from outside the country. They are worried about long-run supply. It is clear, I think, that the Chinese believe that the peak in oil production worldwide will come somewhere around 2013 or so, their representatives say at international meetings. And most representatives of China do not say things that lack the approval of the Chinese government. So they are concerned about the long-term position with regard to China in acquiring additional supplies, and it is part of the outreach to what we regard as rogue nations or near-rogue nations such as Iran and Sudan as they try to lock up sources. The basic point to keep in mind is that when prices rise as they have, that it weakens the position of importing nations in terms of their influence, and it strengthens the position of exporting nations. What can be done about it? Nothing much in the reasonably short term. We will come to some of the medium term and longer term suggestions, but we must recognize that all the cries that you hear about for energy independence going back to President Nixon in 1973, that they are futile given the nature of the American society and the nature of the American economy. It requires us to tell the American motorist to slow down, and he doesn't want to slow down, and he wants to have gasoline at low prices. When President Nixon called for energy independence in 1973, the Federal Energy Office was created. Within a year, there was the Energy Independence Blueprint that indicated that by 1980, we could enjoy energy security. Speak louder. I thought that this was broadcasting me. 1973, we were importing 3 million barrels of crude oil a day. 1980, we were supposed to achieve energy security. Between 1973 and 1980, our imports of crude oil increased by 60%. Today, we are importing well over 10 million barrels of crude a day. And it's plain that the quest for energy independence, at least to this point, has not been an unqualified success. Still, our problem at base is that the political system is unresponsive to the issue. And it will remain unresponsive if you look back over the course of at least these last 35 years. You will note that when gasoline prices go up and the public gets concerned that gasoline prices oil problems, oil energy security are all in the headlines of the newspapers. There is legislation introduced in the Congress, continued hearings. Prices drop off. The headlines disappear. Legislative hearings go on to something else. Until one is able to sustain at least some kind of steadiness in the energy price, we're going to have trouble. The fact of $70 or $60 oil has resulted in a stirring of entrepreneurial juices. There are dozens of firms out there seeking to modify our growing dependence on imported oil. And I might say in passing that our problem is not imported oil per se. Our problem is worldwide the growth of energy demand for which there is that we are pressing against the resource base in one way or another, either geologically or politically. Unless we are able to constrain demand worldwide to some extent, we are going to have a continued pressure on energy prices. It has its good effects, such as stirring those entrepreneurial juices, but it has also the effect of causing serious imbalance in the balance of payments. We're now paying over $300 billion a year to import oil. When I was at the AEC, by the way, and saying that this was going to be a future problem, I said, can you imagine? We might have a balance of payments deficit of $25 billion a year. And what is it now? $750 billion. So there is that problem, but more importantly is the problem that I referred to at the outset, that it undermines our ability to influence other countries. And it leads to competition, to some extent, with other energy importers. Let me pause there, John.
Thank you. I should have taken the opportunity to note that we have some members of our task force here in the audience today. We have Halima Croft here with us, another Lehman Brothers person. And Michael Granoff is here. There may be others, but we do have some members of our task force. I would like to just make a couple of remarks about technology, if I may, in the future. First of all, noting that in the short run, what I think is a universal view of this task force, as Jim has said, is we are going to remain dependent on imported oil, and a lot of it's going to come from the Persian Gulf and bad places, or at least fragile places, such as Saudi Arabia, Iran, Iraq, and Kuwait. In the short run, all we can do is work on demand-side measures. Task force makes a very strong recommendation for an increase in the price of petroleum products, not only to abate demand, but also to encourage innovation. Task force is mixed about what is the best precise mechanism for having that increase in prices. I think Jim and I be quite happy to see a gasoline tax imposed, a petroleum product tax imposed at the right time when prices are coming down rather than going up. But that's hard for our political leaders to understand. We also have to seek in the near term new sources of supply, both inside OPEC, some expansion in the United States and elsewhere. The other important demand side measure recommended by the task force was to try and involve China and India as big consumers, along with the other OECD countries, to look at the common concerns that they have as big consumers of energy: transparent markets, secure lines of transportation, safe from both natural disaster and terrorist attacks, energy infrastructure. But in the longer run, there's going to be a very, very important transition to a post-petroleum world that will only happen if we make investments today to have those options in the future. And that's very important. It's going to happen gradually. There will be a role for both government and industry. It will begin by technologies which make use of unconventional oil and gas, whether it's coal bed methane, whether it's heavy oil, or whether certainly tar sands, as is under expansion right now in Canada. There is a tremendous potential for the right kind of fuels, biofuels from biomass. It's a subject which is quite technical and not yet developed. There's some confusion about whether we should be using food feedstocks like corn and sugar in the United States or cellulosic feedstocks. I'm very much on the side of the energy, the value from the point of view of reducing dependence on oil of using cellulosic feedstocks, but that will take some time to develop. It will come. The task force also wanted to speak out on behalf of nuclear power, recognizing fully that in the short run, electricity does not substitute for liquid fuels. But in the long term, having a carbon-free source of electricity leads to the possibility of going through a sequence of steps towards more electricity-driven transportation as opposed to liquid fuels transportation. All the innovation which is going on in this country is helped by the high fuel prices and the attention which is given to this energy security issue. And if we don't, as I said before, if we don't make those investments at scale today, we will not have the options for making a transition in the future, and life for Americans will be more costly and more disruptive than it otherwise would have to be. Let me stop at that point. And invite comments from the audience on any aspect of this subject that you would like. Yes, sir. And please, I'm sorry, please identify yourself and speak into the microphone, and I don't have to tell you to make your questions brief because our answers will be long.
Stephen Blank, Columbia University Center for Energy, Marine Transport, and Public Policy. Recently, the Security and Prosperity Partnership of North America emphasized that we should be thinking in terms of energy security in a North American format. This was the report delivered to the two presidents and to the Prime Minister of Canada. That would not only mean hydrocarbons from Alberta, it would mean reopening the discussion of massive hydroelectric resources in northern Canada and Quebec, and working with the new Mexican administration of Calderon to secure better energy stability there. But I don't see the words North America at all in the task force report. Obviously, this would not preclude the other, or even be more important than the other recommendations. But why not why weren't you guys interested in the North American option?
Well, we certainly mentioned that we should be opening up our own resources. We had no agreement within the task force whether to open up the North Slope. ANWR, but we said open up our own resources, partly for a region that is derivative from what John was saying, which is we can't go out to the rest of the world and say you should be increasing production of petroleum, and at the same time we say that our resources are too precious to be used. In order to practice what we preach, we should be opening up our own resources. With regard to Canada, we certainly are strongly in support of developing the tar sands. And amongst the technologies that may or may not be coming, the use of oil shale here in the United States, which, were it to develop, would provide a very substantial relief ultimately for our dependence on imported oil. But it's not here yet. It's not going to be here until after 2010 at the earliest. John?
I just want to say that I think the discussion of natural gas in the report, although more abbreviated than our attention on oil, speaks about the North American natural gas is one unit. It's an integrated production and distribution system. So there I think you will find quite an attention on North America with respect to LNG and gas trade in general.
But
yes, sir.
It is not going to substitute ultimately for the dependency on the Middle East. We've got to accept the fact. The president talks about addiction to petroleum. it is not easy to cure addictions.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. My name is Pinkos Javits, and eons ago, with the Hudson Institute, we worked on preparing an energy policy of the United States, which was submitted to you, Professor Schlesinger, and it created the Clean Fuels Corporation. Now, Mr. Herman Kahn was saying, look, we have to not believe that the price of oil is going to go to $100 a barrel. We have to prove by actually doing some kind of work in order to show how much the alternatives would cost. So the creation of the Clean Fuels Corporation was not to create supply, but was to create the knowledge of how much a barrel would cost. Now, he sent me over. I went to Germany, went to all kinds of places to find what technology already existed in the time of the Second World War, and we brought this up. And anyway, that's history now. What I'm trying now to say, and that I'm getting to the point, that in those days, the question was indeed price and supply. Today, the world has changed. We are today also in the know that something like CO2 emissions are going to hamper us. Global change, global warming, climate change are factors. We cannot put them under the rug. Katrina has reminded us of this. I'm involved now with these kind of things, and these days I have a website. Now, that's point one. Point two, there is something called petrocollapse. In effect, petrocollapse has some adherence in U.S. Congress these days, and there is some sort of probable limit to what we can do in order to create supplies. Now, with these two additional factors in mind, I would like to hear from you how you would enlarge on what was just presented, because the questions of price and political involvement on supply today do not suffice. Our problems are much bigger than that.
Thank you.
I'll turn to global warming first. The Department of Energy projects in the next 25 years that the burning of coal will increase by 3 billion tons, well over a billion tons by China. India is not far behind. Indonesia right now burns about 35% of 35% of its firing in its generating plants is by oil. The Indonesian government has said that it wants to reduce that from 35% to 7% by burning more coal. Until such time as we have a worldwide solution rather than a domestic solution, we are not going to deal with the problem of the release of greenhouse gases. We will be playing around with the tail of the dog rather than the dog itself. I sometimes say to those who are most concerned about global warming that they just should pray that they are wrong about the degree of impact that the human being has had on climate, because we aren't going to see much change with regard to the release of greenhouse gases. What was that about price?
We'll go on to another
question. You're going to deal with price?
We're going to go on to another question to give people a chance here. Other comments or questions here? Yes, sir. I certainly can. First of all, I want to tell you how, being an MIT guy, we love fuel cells and actually know a good deal about them. You give the answer with a question, and that is, where is the hydrogen coming from? Today, hydrogen comes from natural gas. That's not terribly interesting. If you make hydrogen from coal gasification and then a water shift reaction, we have this global warming problem that Jim was addressing. So anybody who's for fuel cells and are talking about PEM fuel, so fuel cells, polymer electrolyte membrane fuel cells, which rely on hydrogen, are really saying they're pro-nuclear, which is fine with me. If you tell me that we can envision in the distant future, because that's not going to happen soon, a economy where we have a lot of nuclear electricity capacity, producing hydrogen as a fuel for fuel cells or directly into an internal combustion engine, I celebrate that fact. But right now, it looks quite expensive, and we do have to take the first steps with rejuvenating the nuclear power industry, because the issue of the hydrogen economy is, where is the hydrogen coming from? Yes, sir.
There's going to be plenty of room for fuel cells and a good demand for your product, but it will be marginal in the total energy bulk budget.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Baldass from InScap Management. Would be interested in your observation. In terms of a more widespread medium to long-term development of nuclear energy as an alternative, it would seem to me that certain of the proliferation risks that we face is what is at the nub of creating a more diversified worldwide endeavor on that front. I would be interested in your observations and comments on how we can move forward on that issue and not sort of hamper the development of this important alternative. Thank you.
Well, first of all, I want to stress that this report did not deal with other very important energy security issues, because we felt we were focusing on oil dependence. But I will give you a brief response to that. The prospects for nuclear energy depend upon, really, in my judgment, three very important factors. One is actually building these plants at low cost, progress on radioactive waste management, and the issue, the overriding issue that you mentioned, which is proliferation. And here I must say that the President's initiative, the global nuclear energy program, that he has an element of it which works with other countries to try and go to a new regime where consuming countries, countries who are going to use nuclear power, have proliferation, dangerous technologies, fuel cycle technologies, either enrichment or reprocessing, provided for by nuclear supplier countries like France, Germany, Great Britain, Russia, the United States. And therefore, there's an effort to come to a new regime which will allow for widespread use of nuclear power in the rapidly growing large emerging economies such as China, Indonesia, Turkey, without having access to dangerous proliferation-prone technologies. That is an idea which has very strong bipartisan support in the United States. It may be the only idea that has bipartisan support in the United States. But we yet have an opportunity where we've seen such an arrangement made between nuclear supplier countries with under IEA inspections and a nuclear power using state which has made use of this new offer, which is discussed at the G8 in St. Petersburg and in a whole set of places. So there is really some attention being placed to this issue about how nuclear power can evolve while still taking into account minimization of the proliferation risks.
I should add that the rise of Senator Reid to the position of majority leader has probably not enhanced the prospects for Yucca Mountain and burying wastes in Nevada.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Cy Jacobs from Jacobs Asset Management. You quickly dismissed one of your best suggestions as politically unfeasible, which is a consumption tax on energy to dampen the demand. One of the reasons why it is politically unfeasible is that it is seen as a regressive taxation. Has the task force spent any time thinking about how to ways to shape the tax such that it would we could maintain the progressivity of our tax code?
That's very simple. Take the proceeds of the tax and put it into the Social Security Fund and lower the payroll tax. You still have problems between rural and urban areas because rural people are driving a lot more. But in terms of overall regressivity, it's probably advantageous on balance to put this in place of the payroll tax.
Yeah, that's it.
Thanks. Bob Hormats, Goldman Sachs. I wonder if you could discuss for a minute the linkage between what you've been doing and the war on terrorism. And I'd just like to throw out a couple of quick thoughts. One, the general notion is that 9/11 changed everything. Well, it hasn't changed energy policy for the better. In fact, we're living in a post-9/11 world with a pre-9/11 energy policy. We're more and more dependent on countries that are sponsors or supporters of terrorism. Is there not some way, going back to the point you made, Jim, about the political system, is there not some way of mobilizing the kind of support for a much bolder type of energy policy to reduce dependence, not so much today or tomorrow, but in a relatively short period of time, mobilizing the kind of support that you had in World War II for war bonds and for sacrifice? It seems to me that the political process has failed in not appealing to that set of concerns among Americans to develop a broader consensus to utilize ONWAR, to utilize offshore drilling, to utilize more resources for technology. In other words, the conservationists and the production side need to get together, and it strikes me that in the absence of that, we're not going to have a policy, whereas in as much as we are in a war against terrorism, and it's linked in a very direct way to the amount of money we're spending on oil, we should be able to at least utilize that to develop a broader consensus, and the political system simply has failed to do that. How can you make it, force it, to move it a little bit further in that direction?
Well, a little bit further, perhaps.
Or at least better than it is.
Let me reminisce that once upon a time we had a president who talked about the moral equivalent of war. Described elsewhere rather facetiously as meow. That was a president who was willing to invest a good deal of his political capital, not entirely successfully, in dealing with the energy problem. But his degree of success politically has led to very few politicians who want to emulate Jimmy Carter. That is just a reality. We have a political system in which each senator represents his home state, each member of the House represents his district. It's every man for himself, very little party discipline, and the American public hates higher prices. The notion of sacrifice does not have a great deal of political appeal. I happen to be altogether with you with regard to the desirability of moving in the direction that you've talked about, but there is great resistance out there. I mentioned earlier that when gasoline prices go up, you get headlines, you get legislative hearings, and you have proposals in Congress. When the gasoline prices ceases to go up, you don't hear any more about it. And what you're calling for is kind of a consistent policy that goes over many years. You can't bind the U.S. Congress. No president can control the U.S. Congress. Our system is not as responsive as some of the European countries to the, and particularly Japan, to the need to curtail the growth of energy demand.
Total absence of leadership. If we're in a war against terrorism, then you need leadership that
You may well be right. Fatalism may be the right word. Now, I myself still have black and blue marks from trying to on me from 30 years ago from trying to put a gasoline tax through the U.S. Congress. Back in World War II, we mobilized the country, which I think is your point, but we are unwilling to mobilize the country even for the war on terrorism, which at least after 9/11 had a good deal of carry. We had the Office of War Information, which the press, which was more responsive to government suggestions during World War II than it is today, would follow the releases of the Office of War Information. This is a much more skeptical country than it was in World War II, which I remember quite well.
I want to remind you we need to take a little bit of a break here because this is being national members are participating in this by the internet, and we have a question from a national member, Juan Garcia Pasalacqua from Puerto Rico. So he poses a question that I would like to read as I'm and ask you, Jim. His question is as follows. Has the national interest of the United States moved from the Caribbean to the Caspian Sea due to American addiction of oil? If so, what is the status of oil search in the Gulf of Mexico, between Florida and Cuba? And will this have any effect on future relations with Cuba?
Well, I read in the papers that Castro may be dying. And then I read the next day that it is denied that he may be dying. And whether he lives or does not live has some influence on whether or not we will be supportive of exploration off Cuba. The early part of Mr. Garcia's question, our interest in the Caspian has grown a great deal in recent years because the Caspian looks as if it's going to be more productive in terms of the growth of supply than does the Caribbean. As for the Mexico, since 1938, it has been part of the national patrimony to keep foreign oil companies out, and that has not been productive of a growth of Mexican production.
Yes, back there, please.
Robert Rosenkranz, Delphi Financial Group. You've described today a series of public policy failures and kind of depicted a political environment that makes it hard to imagine that we're going to have much in the way of success. So I'd like to just turn the conversation a little bit to the private sector, because we're now in a mode in terms of prices where there are substantial economic incentives to develop alternatives to oil fuels. And I just wonder if you could comment on the scope for private activity and the extent to which maybe government might be acting as an obstacle to that.
Well, I mean, I think Jim and I are together on this. I mean, we celebrate the fact that the one good fact that comes with higher prices is that it opens these investment opportunities. It opens innovations from shale to fuel cells. And the one most important thing that the government could do to let that energy expand and let that those investments take place is to bring regulatory certainty to it, to try and to the extent possible. And the areas where that could be important are three. One is, as we said, an energy consumption tax, which we favor. We recognize that it's politically impossible. I mean, he says that he had trouble passing a gasoline tax. On the other hand, he was successful at negotiating the windfall profits tax at a time when many people thought that was impossible. So it's not clear that you couldn't craft something. So one is that. The second is the uncertainty having to do with a carbon charge. If you're interested in conversion of shale or coal to liquid fuels, you're going to have to face that. So there are a series of regulatory measures that the government can put in place to make it stable for people to make their investments, and I think that would be the most important thing that could be done.
It is part of the problem that it is very easy to tax producers in this country and very hard to tax consumers. The windfall profits tax had the advantage in that we eliminated the system of controls that had existed up to that point. Decontrol was part of it, but the desire to take a poke at the oil companies was the driving mechanism at the time. I've got to say I'm less proud of the windfall profits tax than I would have been if we had a gasoline
tax. You've
got
to count your successes, Chair.
Such as they are.
Next. Any other? Please.
Gary Rosen from Commentary Magazine. Dr. Schlesinger, what lessons do you draw from your experiences long ago with the Synfuels project? And what, if anything, could be done today in terms of subsidies and tax incentives and whatnot? It sounds from the tone of your report that the essential mechanism for all of you is price, and that if you can maintain a high, consistent price, the free market will do what it does and develop these alternatives. Are subsidies just a politically easy way to show that you're doing something but impractical in the end?
No. You can't get away from the market. You know, if you try to fight the market over time, it's counterproductive. But the beauty of a $70 oil price happens to be that many of the technologies that we previously talked about in that period when we had the Synthetic Fuels Corporation are beginning to look interesting again. We just have the Department of Defense taking advantage of gas to liquids to fuel B-52 bombers. There is continued discussion of moving coals to liquid. That has certain problems, including the environmental problem that John referred to. But a lot of that is coming back. We are going to see the use of coal for gasification in the relatively near future as a supplement to our natural gas supplies. Subsidies help. I am amazed at the people, the number of people, and their partisan affiliations who now have embraced subsidies when in the past they thought that any interference with market forces was reprehensible.
I want to just say one thing on the demand side of this. You're not going to solve this problem with supply only. Mm-hmm. You are going to have to take demand measures as well. We've talked about them in the United States, but demand measures are unpopular in lots of places, including China, including India, where their growth is going up like this. So as we talk about the supply alternatives which are out there, we also have to worry about making sure that we convince not only the United States and the developed economies, which are projected to grow relatively slowly compared to the large emerging economies like India and China.
One aspect I should mention is that the improvement of technology does not necessarily result in energy savings. For example, if you take the hybrid automobile at the present time, much of the improvement has gone into the improved performance of the automobile in terms of acceleration and in terms of size of automobile rather than in terms of energy savings.
Yes, sir.
Jeff Schaefer from Citigroup. You've alluded several times to one potential source of domestic energy substitution as being coal, of which we have a lot, and the fact that it does raise greenhouse gas issues. Where are we along the technological possibilities frontier in terms of developing ways that would effectively solve the CO2 problem with coal, which would make a tremendous difference in terms of the potential for energy independence in the U.S. and also in China and India?
Is this a planted question, John?
He's a Citicorp guy, so maybe it is.
Jeff, you've given me an opportunity to make a plug. MIT is just about to issue a study on the future of coal. I guess it'll come out in February when it's really produced. But our view is that if you are willing to spend, roughly speaking, about 40% more to generate your electricity from coal, you could pay for the costs of CO2 capture, transportation, and then sequestration. Now, the issue is, having said that, it's easy to say, where are we in the world on having a project that demonstrates that you could do that at those costs, technically done properly, and very, very importantly, that you have the regulatory framework which allows you to choose a site, do the injection of the site, monitor, and verify that the CO2 is where you think it is, understand what the leakage is. Leakage is not, like in the case of nuclear waste, radioactive. It's just a way of seeing how well you're doing. And also worry about the liability of that site after a period of time when the company that placed it down there is no longer responsible for it. The short answer is that we're nowhere at this. There is no project going on anywhere in the world which is establishing carbon capture and sequestration as a realistic technical option should all those goofy political and policy people say you want to take it on. And that, I think, is really one of the extraordinary short-sightedness of the debate which goes on in this country, to some extent in Europe too, that people assume technology will happen without really paying attention to it, either with respect to the quality of the management of it or with respect to the magnitude of the effort.
And we can't apply the same standards we do to nuclear waste, that there will be no leakage for the next 25,000 years.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. The tripling of the price of oil is painful for us, but it is devastating for dozens of small countries which are not producers. What are the national security consequences of the ripple effect among our allies?
Unrest. Unrest in those countries, which is not helpful, even if they were relatively stable before, they become less stable. And so the national security consequences are that they add to instability in the world generally. However, generally these are smaller nations without a great deal of political power, and we worry more about larger countries like Russia, Iran, etc., which seem to be growing in political strength.
I think there's also a short-run concern with the larger or smaller of these countries, concern about security of supply, access to supply, and so there's a new enthusiasm for state-to-state agreements that is trying to reach an agreement with between a particular consuming country and a producer, and that does lead not only to a less transparent economic market, but also to the kind of political influence that Jim was stressing before. The trend of state-to-state agreements between national oil companies is a very, very different and, in my mind, quite troublesome trend in world oil markets compared to what they were 10 years ago. Yes, sir.
Alan McGowan, the New School. I was in Egypt 2 weeks ago talking about Middle East peace, and I thought they were pessimistic. You guys are making them look like Pollyanna. What is your realistic prospect of the next 20 years? What is possible and what can be done in both a technical and a social sense to ameliorate some of the issues that you're talking about?
Well, go back to the President's State of the Union address, in which he said that we were going to cut a quarter or importation of oil from the Middle East. Well, it turned out that's not directed towards the Middle East. And what we were going to do was to cut a quarter from the then year projected use of oil of about 25.5 million barrels or 26 million barrels a day back to the level of the present time, which is 21 million barrels a day. So success means standing still in that respect. What could we do? Nothing immediately that is going to have a major effect, but over time we probably can carve. In addition to holding at 21 million barrels a day, we probably can reduce it. 30 years out, we can look forward to the possibility of hybrid cars. That may require subsidization, hybrid cars in the sense of plug-in hybrids rather than the hybrid that we have today. And if the political system is prepared to move in that direction and to subsidize the development of that industry, we can probably substantially cut from the present level. But we still are going to be dependent on imported oil as long as we make use of the internal combustion engine and airline traffic.
Yes, sir.
Dick Huber, I'm an investor and the director of a company called Covanta Energy, and therefore my question is, with reference to that, this is the largest waste energy company in America, which is a technology that is far more developed and utilized in Europe and Japan, and is almost related to the trash heap, appropriately enough, here in the U.S. And we talk about windmills and solar cells and whatnot. We today, this company, generate enough electricity to fully power a city the size of Philadelphia, burning garbage. And yet, most cities, and New York being one of them, transport garbage hundreds of miles using hydrocarbons to do it, to dump it in a hole in Pennsylvania or Ohio, and maybe that's a good thing to do for Pennsylvania or Ohio, but it certainly is wasting a tremendous opportunity to turn trash to energy. Do you have any comments on why it seems to be such a stepchild in our economy?
It is not the only thing that we are wasteful about. If you go back to the National Energy Plan of 1977, district heating would have resulted in a substantial savings compared to comparing the United States with Europe, which uses district heating. The Swedes, for example, are very effective in the use of district heating, which cuts the heating bill and the heating requirement substantially. With regard to waste, I think that it waste of the sort that you're talking about, I think that this is a question of subsidization, and we are unprepared to.
We don't really need it. I mean, it can compete in today's world with today's prices with no subsidy.
But we celebrate that. I mean, I think everybody in this task force, I can speak, I think on this point, for everybody in the task force, if there is a energy technology out there which is economic and produces liquid fuels especially or electricity without harming, without environmental side effects, we are all for it, and we just want to get out of the way and let those things succeed. Yes, sir.
The average fuel efficiency of our fleet, I think, hasn't changed since 1996 or 1970. My name is Jay Bernstein. I'm in the energy business. The average fleet has been remained pretty constant. Is it any more politically palatable to mandate higher fuel efficiency? I mean, there are a sizable piece of our fleet is it won't be usable in China in 2008. But we can't seem to have that will.
I think that certainly there are many members of the task force who say that because we can't do some of these other measures like a tax, that we are for strengthening a CAFE in a variety of different ways that are discussed, including SUVs and light trucks and things like that. And on the other hand, we have to recognize that our purpose is to use less petroleum, not to drive more miles more efficiently. And so CAFE in that extent is an indirect approach to the problem, but certainly if you can't do better, that's a step in the right direction. And hopefully it's not something that will disadvantage U.S. auto companies.
But when we move from 12.5 miles per gallon to 25 miles per gallon, we double the efficiency of automobiles. When you move from 25, let's say, to 32, you have less savings. We are moving in this direction very slowly. We have just applied higher standards to trucks being the loophole that Americans use to avoid the effects of CAFE standards.
Yes.
Hi, Dan Rosen, China Strategic Advisory and Institute for International Economics. I guess at some price, demand falls off sufficiently and new technology comes on the scene on the supply side sufficiently to fix the catastrophic failure of U.S. policy that you've described over the past, you know, post-war period, really. Do you have a sense of what that price might be? I mean, we're specifically talking in the study about oil. And any thinking on the task force about, you know, what share of the total U.S. economy would have to shift to covering a higher energy bill and what it might be taken away from? Is it, you know, less health care we can afford? Is it less something else? What are we going to sacrifice to resolve this unresolvable political failure?
Sounds like a dismal economist to me. I mean, the one thing which will solve this problem is a... I didn't say that it was an unwelcome view. I just the one thing which can solve this the one thing which can solve this problem is a much, much reduced rate of economic growth in the globe. That will have a big effect on some of these numbers. But that's not a solution that I think we're eager to advance. But that certainly would have an effect. And in some sense, I've got to tell you, when you look at the IEA, the International Energy Agency, or our own Energy Information Administration, projections out to 2030, it's hard to see how you can make this, realize these set of estimates. There's going to be some bumps in the road there.
Sacrifice is something that is not very appealing politically in this democracy. It's not very appealing in any system, but we have dispersion of powers, which George III gave us, and it makes it very hard to organize in the way that Bob suggested with the organizing the public for massive change.
Yes, sir.
Sir Roy Goodman of the United Nations Development Corporation, you touched lightly a few moments ago on the matter of atomic energy as a substitute for some of the other types of energy we've been discussing. Is there any reason why atomic energy should be discarded and not used as a major component of any solution to this problem? It strikes me that it's a thing in which very few people have been severely injured, few have gotten nauseous and have vomited as a result of mishaps with atomic energy, but other than that, very little damage has been done, even where accidents have occurred. Isn't this a logical place for us to turn? This time.
I think we've discussed that some here today, and certainly it's mentioned in the report. I think the issues there are cost, managing the wastes, and especially these proliferation issues as you go to developing nations. But I think on balance, certainly this task force recommends.
There's no good reason, but there are lots of effective political reasons, starting with the aforementioned opposition to Yucca Mountain of the gentleman who will soon be the majority leader of the U.S. Senate.
We'll take one last question from you, ma'am, and please.
Yes, my name is Tina Vitale from Standard & Poor's Equity. Biofuels would not exist without government subsidies, and and for the most part, they're not technologically as efficient as fossil fuels. Has your task force looked at whether the plans that are currently being proposed for the growth of biofuels, particularly here in North America, are realistic, and what impact this might have on conventional fuel infrastructure plans, particularly on refining, because these take many years to develop, and if some of these biofuel plans don't pan out, then we might be left short.
Well, we mentioned this earlier. There are two kinds of biofuels. The ones which look like they have most promise in the longer run are cellulosic-based, and they do have the prospect of maybe producing 2 million barrels of oil per day. It would not be difficult for a healthy refinery industry to include those in the motor gasoline pool of the country. Jim, do you have any final words you would like to say, sir?
Look, there's a reason that we have become addicted to oil, and that is that you have greater energy density and greater convenience in the use of oil than there is in any other fuel. And breaking that addiction is not going to come easily. The addiction has grown since the Arab oil embargo, and whether or not this is unduly pessimistic, it probably will continue to grow.
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank once again Pete Peterson and Richard Haass for having assembled this task force and given us the opportunity to discuss this issue and present you with this report. And I want to thank you all very much for attending here today and discussing this with us and for the comments that we've heard. I do hope that each one of you goes back there and tries to change the pessimism we have into effective action going forward. Thank you all very much.